Good evening and welcome to each and every one of you, and thank you for being here tonight on this important occasion. My name is Amos Quick, a proud James B. Dudley graduate, class of 1986. I am honored to be here on the stomping grounds of my alma mater, and I'm proud to welcome you to be here tonight as well. We want to thank Dudley High School for hosting this event. We want to thank Mr. Rodney Wiles, who is our principal, and congratulations are in order to Mr. Wiles, as he and Dudley just received the Hubert Humphrey Award as the most improved high school in Guilford County. Especially to Mr. Wiles are we appreciative, because this is the second time he has been the principal of a school that has received that, as Andrews High School received it under his leadership as well. Then can we please show appreciation for the drum line that greeted us as we came in. Were they not awesome? We're so thankful for the many and well-rounded education that the students receive here at Dudley High School, and the arts are certainly a part of that. There are some, I see, at least one, a candidate for elective office, and I wanted to introduce him, and I don't see any other elected officials, but Mr. Byron Gladden is here. He is a candidate for the school board District 7. District 7 will be a new district as of December the 1st, and that district will include Dudley High School, so we are appreciative that he's here. This session is the first of many gatherings that our superintendent, whom I will more formally introduce in just a minute, where she is going around our county and learning about us in what has been deemed a listening and learning tour. The purpose of this tour is to learn how we can shape a better future for our schools, our students, our families, and our communities. This is so important that we hear from you, because all of us in this community, whether we acknowledge it or not, or whether we know it or not, we are all invested in the success of Guilford County Schools. Whether we have school children or whether we are supporting the schools as taxpayers, Guilford County Schools are our schools, and we all should be interested and invested in their success. It gives me delight to introduce the new superintendent of Guilford County Schools. Her name is Sharon Contreras. Her title is Dr. Sharon Contreras. She comes to us from Syracuse, New York, by way of Providence, Rhode Island, by way of Clayton County, Georgia, by way of New York, where she was born and raised. She has been a successful educator throughout this nation. President Obama called on her knowledge when he wanted to talk about raising the achievement of students. The New York State Legislature called on her expertise when they wanted to find out how to better educate students around the issue of suspensions and expulsions. And Guilford County Schools is fortunate to have her to serve as our superintendent. She is a history maker, but she's also a person who is interested in the success of each and every student. Without any further ado, I introduce to you to our superintendent, Dr. Sharon Contreras, and ask that we receive her with a round of applause.
Thank you so much. It's such a great pleasure to be here at the infamous Dudley High School. And I tell you, everywhere I go, people tell me I graduated from Dudley High School, so I couldn't wait to get here. I look forward to visiting during the school day, when I will have the opportunity to meet the students, meet the great faculty and staff, and certainly I've had the opportunity already to meet our fearless leader here, Principal Wiley. So it is a pleasure to greet each of you and just to talk to you a little bit before we open it up to each of you to share your hopes and dreams, the things you see that are working well in the district, just to let you have an opportunity to get to know you, to get to know me. So I often say there's a line in the movie Excalibur where they ask, where King Arthur asks Merlin, how did you get here? And he says, think back, Arthur, think back. And so my story actually begins before I was born. My parents already had six children. They had had two girls and four boys, and they said they wanted another girl. So here I am, and I said to them, who plans for a seventh child, Ma? And they did that, and so I'm here. But I'm so proud of my family and all that my parents instilled in me. I think about my parents, and it's really a story of the American dream. My paternal grandparents, grandfather, immigrated through Ellis Island from Venezuela. My grandmother is from Puerto Rico. My maternal grandparents are from Edgefield County, South Carolina, where they worked as sharecroppers. They all moved with one goal in mind. They wanted a better life for their children. They wanted an education, something we take for granted because it's so free now that everyone has a right to go to school. But even my father did not attend school regularly. He was a foster child in New York City, and the foster parents in the home he was in used him as a servant. They did not send him to school. I think of my grandparents who pushed and pushed us so that we would never, ever have to do the backbreaking work that they had to do in South Carolina. And they would tell us over and over again, education is the way out. These are people who worked hard to make sure that we all went on to college, and I have nine siblings, but they worked hard. I remember my grandmother was a domestic worker, and then she worked in a store, a department store called Corvettes, which was in New York, and she cleaned the bathrooms, and we used to have to go with her. And we didn't even know. We thought it was a playground. We were just being there while she was cleaning up after people and scrubbing the toilets. But they bought homes. They made sure we had a home. They made sure that all of us went on to college. And you know, like any typical family, some of us completed right on time. Some of us, it took a little longer. But we completed college, and we have approximately 21 degrees between us today. And that's because of our parents and grandparents and their hope for us. It's also because of their advocacy. And my parents were not by any means folks who would be out and picketing and working as grassroots people. But when they saw injustice in schools, they would speak up. We, even in Long Island, New York, we, my brothers and sisters, and I were sent to a school to desegregate it. We had to desegregate schools. I hear the mic went off. Is the mic still on? Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Okay. They worked with us to desegregate schools, and we had to go by bus every single day to a different part of town, even though there was a school right there on the corner. I could throw a rock at the school. We could not attend that school. So we would attend the new school across town, and we were on bus A, the bus letter A. But they would park that bus around the corner so that no one would see us get off the bus. So while the rest of the buses were in order, B, C, D, E, F, G, A was around the corner. So sometimes people, when they tell the story of integration and the fight for equal schools in this country, they put it all on the South. But I'm telling you, that happened in the 1970s.
That's right.
In Long Island, New York. We also were not able, we didn't have the same opportunities as many other students until my parents fought for us to participate in gifted education programs, which changed the trajectory of my life. This was when tracking was normal. You had track 1, 2, 3, 4. And students who were in tracks 3 and 4 very rarely went off to college. They were in the old-fashioned vocational programs that didn't really prepare you for middle-class jobs. But my parents wanted to make sure that we had better. They made sure we had access to gifted programs, to honors programs. They made sure that the school did not hold us back. One of the reasons I'm so passionate about education today is because I understand how it can change your life. My grandmother used to say, no one can take what's here and no one can take what's here. They can take your money, you could lose your health, but they can't take who you are, your character. They can't take what you know. And I share that with young people all the time. I sometimes see young people who have very vivacious personalities in the neighborhood, but they get into a classroom and they will not speak because they don't have background knowledge. They are fearful and ashamed because they don't have the same knowledge as some of their peers who live right in the same county. And we have to make sure that all of our students are well prepared. I see that out, that providing an education is a moral issue for us. I think about our work in this nation, and there's an increasing push to eradicate poverty. I just want to share some numbers with you because I think this is really powerful. And this came out just today from Marion Wright Edelman, the great children's crusader from the Children's Defense Fund. But she shared today that the poverty data just released by the U.S. Census Bureau revealed child poverty declined last year to 14.5 million poor children from 15.5 million in 2014. The child poverty rates declined for black children, white children, Asian children, and Hispanic children. And this, of course, is good news. But despite the good news, children of color are still disproportionately poor and comprise nearly 70% of poor children in the United States. Nearly half of all poor children in the United States are not just poor, they live in extreme poverty. This kind of poverty, we know, jeopardizes the future of our young people and places our national military and our economic stability at risk in this country. So I feel like education is the way out. We have to ensure high quality education for these children, our early childhood development program for these children, so they have a chance to make it in this country. Now, for some people, they believe, well, that's not my responsibility. But when you think about what this could do to our democracy, to our national security, and to our economic stability, it is about all of us, as you say, Reverend Quick. And let's think about when students don't receive a great education, when we know that this poverty is impacting their education, it causes failure and long-time failure. These statistics are just incredible to me. Today, 2 out of 3 eighth grade students can't read proficiently, and most of them will never catch up. Some 1.1 million American high school students drop out every single year. That's more than 6,000 students every school day, and one student every 26 seconds is dropping out of high school in this country. For African American and Latino students, dropout rates are close to 40% compared to the national average of 27. Dropping out has dire consequences for the dropout. Nearly 44% of dropouts under the age of 24 are jobless. And the unemployment rate of high school dropouts older than 25 is more than 3 times that of a college graduate. Dropouts from the class of 2007 will cost our nation more than $300 billion, not million, billion in lost wages, lost taxes, and lost productivity. And a dropout is more than 8 times as likely to be in jail or prison as a high school graduate and nearly 20 times as likely as a college graduate. 65% of U.S. prisoners are high school dropouts, and a lack of education is one of the strongest predictors of criminal activity in this nation. But if 5% more young men in high school graduated, America would see an annual savings of $4.9 billion in crime-related costs. There is an increasing sense of hopelessness based on the facts. Only 4% of Americans raised at the bottom of the economic ladder will rise to the top as adults. And nearly two-thirds of African Americans who grow up in middle-class families will fall to the lower rungs as adults. Public schools in other countries are more of a lever for social mobility that help children of all backgrounds. So I'm often asked after I say things like that, so who in the world would take the job as a superintendent? And I'm here to say I would, and it is my joy to do so, because despite these kinds of numbers, I believe that we can turn it around. We can give all students great opportunities, make sure that they have equal access, equal opportunity to a great education, and we can help every student reach their potential. Not just poor children, but certainly we know if poor children do not receive a great education, there are dire consequences for our communities, our county, our state, our country, our world. But for every student, making sure that academically gifted students receive the education they receive, special needs students, second language learners. Our schools are asked to do much, but we can provide students with a great education. And there is no reason, given the power we have, the collective power we have as a community, that we can't turn every one of the schools around in Guilford County. We can help the highest performing schools do even better. We can close achievement gaps in our high performing schools. We can turn around low performing schools, but we cannot do it by ourselves. People look to me and they say, Superintendent, we know you're going to turn it around. And I said, yes, I am with you, because I cannot do this. I need the parents, I need the community organizations, the faith-based community, the business community, the elected officials, all to say, we stand for children. We will do what is right for children, because they are gifted and talented beyond measure, and we believe in them. So I thank you this evening for coming out tonight. I thank you for saying, not so much I stand with you, Sharon, but I stand with you, Sharon, because you stand for children, and we in Guilford County believe in children. So thank you so very much.
As we can see, we have a superintendent whose passion is not hidden, nor is it hard to see, and whose focus on children and youth and their success is evident every time that I've seen her throughout this process, from the first time that we met her in the hiring process to now. The motivation and the emphasis and the passion has been the same and has not wavered. Also want to pause just once again to introduce another who has joined us tonight, Attorney Tanya Cutchin, who is a candidate for a district court judge. So thank you for being here tonight. We appreciate it. So now the superintendent has gone around to different groups in the community, and she has met with different people in public and private settings. This is the first of the, quote, listening and learning tour stops that she will make. Other board members will host the superintendent in their district, and she will speak to them. So we are privileged tonight to be the first. The purpose of our listening and learning tour is to gain information that will assist the superintendent in developing and crafting her strategic plan to move the district forward and to build a stronger Guilford County Schools. In order to do that, we need to hear from you. So tonight we have designed a process that will allow us, hopefully, to hear from as many people as possible. We have a few questions that we want to present to you as a community. And if you would like to respond to those questions, we ask that you will raise your hand, and one of the staff members who are here present will bring you a microphone so that you can respond to the question. We ask that you would please wait until you receive the microphone to begin your response. Also, to be fair and that we can hear from as many people as possible, please try to generate your responses within a minute or two, and we'll try to make our way around so that we don't miss out on anything important. Also, as you came in, hopefully you've received a sheet of paper with three questions. We ask that you would respond to those questions, and at the end of the program tonight, that you would leave them with one of GCS staff members who are present. If you have any additional questions, we do have note cards for you, and Ms. Mobley is standing in the middle there with note cards. Feel free to write your question down along with your name and your email address. And as we move through this 100-day period of transition, a superintendent and her staff will be responding to these questions. That is the process. Please, let's be respectful of the process so that we can have as much input as possible. With those ground rules being set, again, thank you for being here tonight, and we are ready to begin. The first question, yes, sir.
Ask a question or statement.
You can have a question if it's about process, yeah.
Well, I came out, Dr. Contreras, because I've been involved for the last 5 years, 100% at the podium, school board, and sometimes I felt alone. I'm from Laurelton, Queens, too, by the way, from New York. I've been down here 20 years, and I'm honored to be with you, and I will protect you if it's righteous. I didn't want to be called part of the, everybody likes the show. All I came to do is see you, sister, and say I would like to meet with you, because it can't take overnight, and it ain't going to be a one-night, three-minute question. I need time to what I've been given and what I've seen and absorbed in these last 5 years. When I'm at that podium and I turn around, I'm lonely. But everybody comes to see the superintendent, and I know that I'm at the most challenging school in the district. I'm an ambassador and a parent liaison at Harrison. My superintendent is back there.
Get to your question.
So thank you, Amos.
Okay.
He also is my superintendent, and I wanted to just give her that because those things will be missed because it's just cookie cutter stuff. Sure. I want her to feel my, and almost like I was home, my rescuer, like Esther in the Bible, for such a time as this you're here. And I hope you can bring that full fruition. But I would like to meet with you, if you can. Give me a lot of time to meet with you, and I can further have conversation with you. Is that possible?
If you'd please give your name and contact information to one of the staff. I am meeting with as many people as possible. Also, I'm hosting backyard chats for any of you in your homes that want to convene a small group. I will come out and speak in your neighborhoods, and you don't have to come to me. I'll come to your home and just talk to you about your concerns, also the good things that are happening. But I would love to hear about what you believe some of the solutions are to the problems. You know, I like to think I'm a well-informed person, well-educated, but I don't have all the answers. So I look forward to meeting with you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hughes.
Thank you.
All right. So now the first of three questions that we will ask, and again, it's designed that so at the end there will be some opportunity for a little more than ask the questions. No problem. The first question is, in your opinion, what does Guilford County Schools do well, do really well? In your opinion, what does Guilford County Schools do really well? And if there are those who would like to answer that question, keeping your answer to around 1 minute, notes are being taken, and then we'll move to the next question.
Okay.
To you. This is being recorded to be shown later, so we need to use the microphone. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Brenda James, Brenda Dalton James, and I'm a class of 1963. I graduated from this great institution, James Benson Dudley, in 1963. And I have two sons that graduated 84 and 85, and my ex-husband graduated in 63 also. So I have a long history here at Dudley and have been involved in the National Alumni Association since 1982 in various capacities, and am a volunteer, and so I'm very involved here at my school. I love my school, and anybody who knows me knows that. But to get to your question, I think Guilford County Schools does a lot of things well. I think they provide opportunities for students to engage in many, many different activities. They provide a large variety of programs, classes for students of all interest groups, not only just the academics, but also the arts, also the special technical schools or the career academies, career programs, so that students who come to Guilford County Schools can just, and foreign language classes and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You get my point. So I think they do that well. They have a wide variety of programs that any student who attends Guilford County Schools can participate in. Also, of course, the athletic programs, the arts, band, you heard our band, we have drama, we have choir, we have all those other kinds of art, and as well as the visual arts. So those things we do well here in Guilford County. I think staffing is good. I think staffing of our schools are good. Classes are still overcrowded. That's one of the things that we don't do well. We don't keep some of our classes small enough so that we feel that the students are getting individual attention. I think a lot of students are in definitely overcrowded classrooms, and we need to do a little bit more in that area as far as classroom size and teacher-student ratio. Especially when you have students who, as you mentioned, may not be as free to share in large groups as some of the other students, and they get lost in the shuffle. And I think smaller classes would help that.
Thank you for that. And we will get to those things that we can improve in just a moment. So the question now is, what things does Guilford County Schools do really well? I think that's you. Good evening.
I also agree that Guilford County Schools provide a lot of different programs and activities for students. That's one of the things that we do well, and I've taught in three different school systems, so I believe that the facilities for most of the schools in Guilford County are some of the best in the state. We have some really nice schools in Guilford County, so I think that's one of the things that we do well. We provide really good facilities at most of our schools, especially the newer schools and the schools that have had additions like Dudley in recent years, that they are very well built and equipped. That's one of the things that I think we do well.
Thank you very much. Anyone else want to answer this? Dr. Carter, and then there's a young lady in the back.
Good evening. I've seen Guilford County Schools fight against some of the poor legislation that has come down, where the community would not know what was going on. I've seen the school board take opposition and send letters to the state to stand against those. And I can't, it's escaping, I can't articulate them right now. But I've seen that and I have appreciated that.
Thank you very much for that. And the school board did sue the state about teacher tenure and won that lawsuit.
Yes, good evening, my name.
Good evening.
Paulette Bernard, and I have a middle school student at Acock Middle School. And one thing that I know Guilford County Schools do well, it's communication. They get the word out to the parents. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else that would like to respond to that question? In your opinion, what does Guilford County Schools do really well? Okay, thank you all very much for your responses. The next question is the flip side of that coin. In your opinion, where can we improve? In your opinion, where and what can we improve as a school system? And please raise your hands and we'll get a microphone to you.
I think one of the most important improvements you can make as a school system would be at the high school level, as far as scheduling classes for students with different abilities, and especially more classes that would provide students the kind who drop out of school. When I was writing a book recently about Dudley, some of the young people that I talked to said one of the reasons they dropped out of school or one of the reasons they graduated from school without the ability to go to college or to get a job was because they did not offer enough classes that they could take that would enable them to get a job. For example, we have an auto mechanics program, but it's relatively small. And there are not that many students that can get it, and we haven't had enough money to really enlarge the program so that more students could take it. So we need more technical classes and industrial classes that would enable our students to get jobs when they get out of school. Not every student is going to go to college. And right now, the high schools in Guilford County are designed for all students to go to college. Our programs that we spend the most money on are like IB programs, which is a classic education. We need more of technical education courses in the system. Right now, only about 12% of Guilford County's courses at the high school level are technical classes and industrial arts type classes. We need more classes like that for the students who are not going to college so that when they graduate from high school, they can get a job. At one time here at Dudley, we had all kinds of industrial arts programs that enabled students. We had, like you said, there were tracks. I had the option. I graduated from Dudley in 1967. And students who graduated with me could either be on a track to go to college, and we could take college-level courses, or we could be on a track to work in different industries in Guilford County. When we graduated in different businesses. But all of those programs have been taken out of the high schools now. And there's very little for people, students who are not going to college to do. Only 84% of the students in North Carolina go to college. The rest of them graduate and either get a job or don't have the ability to get a job once they leave school. So
I thank you for those comments, and I know this isn't the section where I respond, but I feel compelled to respond to that. A few things. We are preparing students for college or workforce so that they have options. It is extraordinarily important that we realize that 7 out of 10 of the high growth fields require post-secondary education, even if it's 2-year college. But the days of completing high school and going to the factory and working are over. Most of the jobs that do not require post-secondary experience are low-wage jobs. They will not allow students to live a self-sustaining life. So part of this is a mindset change. I certainly agree that not all students are going to go off to college right away, but we need to help them understand if you choose not to go, this is the quality of life you will likely live. So I am thinking about jobs like automotive programs. Some of those jobs are being done through robotics now. What used to be manual labor now is being replaced through technology. 7 out of 10 of the future jobs require that students have high skills in technology. So it is important that we encourage students to be prepared for post-secondary education, or else they will be in low-wage jobs and not be able to take care of their families. So to your point that not all are going, that's absolutely correct. But it is my job to give them the option by preparing them to be successful in either college, to go into the military, or to go into the workforce if they so choose.
Well, that's what I'm basically saying. Yeah. There are more options for students who are not going to college. We don't have enough of those programs that train them to do other things other than to go to college.
And we are going to take a deep dive in that. I know we have more than 150 CTE courses right now. I don't know if they lead to licensure. These are some of the questions I have. And are they equitably distributed throughout the county? That's important to know as well.
There really are not. There are not that many courses. Just like here at Dudley, those courses are usually, most of those courses have students who are in the academy, and they're not open to the other students who attend school here.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that information.
Thank you very much. Mr. Gladden, I think. And the question is, in your opinion, what can we improve? What can we improve?
What are where we can improve? I'll have to start with, in terms of just continual transparency with the data and the information that we have. For example, the breakdown of the SPG, a lot of things that are coming up. I just left a forum today where they're talking about how we have low-performing schools, we have failing schools. No one was really wanting to talk about growth. Now, growth counts for 20% of the SPG, but here in Guilford County, we stress that growth is more relevant and more important than the actual letter grade. So I'm one of the things hoping that in these town halls, for those who may have gotten the report from the ready results that their school is an F or their school is a D, and to better clarify that, you know, the majority of the schools that have rating C, D, and F are over 50% in poverty, and that poverty correlates with the school's actual letter grade, just to give some, you know, for transparency with the community, because, you know, it's putting people alarm, and it's great for those who are charter school advocates and school choice voucher advocates that your schools are failing. Why not go to a charter school? So with that, I feel that we need to expand upon more about our culture in terms of, I know we have the website about the history of how we came to be desegregated. I don't feel that we ever integrated, we desegregated. But transparency in terms of how race, not only in our schools, because race affects us and we see color as a community. And so to incorporate that with our teachers, with diversity, I'm concerned with the fact that SROs in Guilford County make 110% of the national average. And we are struggling for TAs. Out of that budget for the state, they give us approximately $37,000 to pay SROs, and we offset the difference with what the contract is presented. And we've been doing that since 2003. We're placing more emphasis on security for our children instead of books for our children, instead of TAs for our children, instead of other electronics for our children, because security, it seems to be of higher concern. And with that same $37,000 budget, we can hire additional assistant principals. There's things in that budget, we don't have to just dedicate it to SROs. To encourage principals to know that they don't have to have an SRO in their high school or middle school. They have the option to choose to do something else with that money, to empower our principals to have choice about where they want, you know, with that particular piece of the budget, they have the option to do so and run their own schools.
Thank you very much. Dr. Carter, and then that's, all right, I'm sorry, Mr. He's going to go, Dr. Carter. Mr. Noon.
I wanted to,
and the question is, what can we improve? Yeah.
We'll start the conversation, but I'll have to leave shortly. My son's getting out of driver's ed in about 15 minutes or so, and I didn't want to miss the opportunity to buttress what the young lady right here said and what Mr. Gladden said. So what I'm about to say is may could comport to what we do well and what we can improve and what advice I have. It may fit all three, four I'm about to leave. I'm the political action chair in the NAACP. And it won't be two minutes. Well, just a piece of information. We just did a diversity study here in Guilford County Schools, if I'm not mistaken. And just for edification for everyone here, not as just for the superintendent, Guilford County Schools invest $60+ million a year into the community. Guilford County Schools is 48% black, 43% white. $60 million of those dollars goes to the white community. Greensboro City invests $140 million a year into the community. Oil changes, cutting grass, you name it. Greensboro's 47% white, 43% black. When I ask everybody this question, what proportion do you believe black folks receive? They'll give me 30 million, 40 million. And they dismay when I tell them it's less than three. The county is over $260 million a year investment in this community. Now asking the same question, what proportion do you believe the black community receive? And they'll give me, after I tell them the first two, they'll lower it to 10%. That's 20 million, give or take. They're surprised when I tell them it's less than two. So you're talking $500 to $600 million that's being invested in the white community every year, and less than 10 to the black. We're not gonna fix none of this unless we hold our local government accountable. Your Guilford County School Superintendent, that's the board's job. We've talked to, in my capacity, Alan Duncan, Mayor Vaughn, and Jeff Phillips. They obfuscate, they perpetuate stories, innuendos, excuses. Understand, family, it's over $600 million every year. The state goal is 10%. That means we're missing $50 million a year in your community that would impact schools, that allow your child, if he didn't want to go to med school and want to do pet grooming, he can do it and succeed. He can dream in other ways other than college, even though he has a collegiate mind. Everyone else can dream like that. Our children can't. I could go on and on and on in that capacity. I want you to know it's not always fighting that black and white issue, half the fight I have with black folks, because too many of us historically have gained favor from that same corrupted system. So when I say this, this should make you feel a certain way, 600 million to 10. No excuses, but I get excuses all the time, and there's no excuse for that. We're talking about cutting grass, oil change, roofing, wiring, pressure washing, paper towel, toilet paper, soap. We're not talking building skyscrapers. To what that young lady right there said, I wasn't going to say anything until she said that Mr. Byron Gladden spoke up. And until we address that, and that's not going to be in Ms. Contreras, it's going to be in everyone in here. You have to address that with your local leadership. You have to ask them why they're not speaking to that. You know, the old adage from the 60s, talking loud but ain't saying nothing. That's exactly what I hear half the time I'm out here. Sorry if I went over, Amos. Appreciate you.
Appreciate that. Dr. Carter.
I wanted to address the technology or lack of technology within across our county, and particularly in the black community. So I believe in better ways Gifford County Schools can help us to have maybe more Wi-Fi spread throughout the black community so that children will be able to use that not only at school but perhaps at home. Secondly, extended communication. In other words, we've got to work together to develop an infrastructure where communication, as it relates to public schools, not only comes to parents and grandparents, but it's got to come to community. And we've got to find the who is going to get it and act on it. But I believe that Gifford County Schools, working with the community, can do a better job on extended communication. The last piece is on, as it relates to graduation rates. It is my hope, Dr. Contreras, that having an acceptable or a high graduation rate will not be the priority, as opposed to having students who are prepared when they graduate. I think we can do a better job on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. This young lady here.
I misunderstood. I would like, if it's not now, but I jumped the cart before the horse.
I tried to tell you that's what you was doing.
Well, you know, I love
yeah, yeah.
I'm like,
that's all right. You okay? So we're answering now the question, in your opinion, what and where can Gifford County Schools improve?
My name is Shannon Myers. I'm an art teacher here at Dudley High School. Along with her comments about the technology, here in our school, and I haven't taught at any other large schools other than Dudley, I have classes that are up to 32 students. Our computer labs fit 24. So my standard course of study actually includes heavily using technology to teach them how to make art. But I can't get them into the computer lab where they can each all use their own and work on their own. And working in pairs on a computer really doesn't work very well. So I also think that we need more technology, and to review the class sizes and the computer lab sizes that we put in schools so that teachers can actually use them effectively. The other thing that I would like to see improved, being an art teacher, is funding for the arts. Many art teachers are not actually given a true budget. We have to ask and hope we receive, which means that we don't ask for the moon because we're afraid that we won't receive anything. And I think that improving the way that we encourage principals to have choice But then to give those choices out and, you know, be able to say, well, you could have this. And if I know what I'm going to be able to spend each year on supplies that disappear quickly, like, because I have to provide paper, color pencils, markers, they don't last forever, that I can plan my lessons better. And I think a lot of teachers feel the same way about budgeting for special projects around school that encourage learning outside of the classroom. And I know many teachers use things like Donors Choose and things like that to fund their classrooms. I actually have a program going that just came live today, trying to get drawing boards and paper so my students can go outside or around the school to draw and not be stuck in our 68-degree classroom.
I would like to respond to that. I want you to know that this is a board of education that is deeply committed to giving students everything that they need. That means giving you what you need to teach. However, some of this is beyond the district. And the one thing I want to just really push for is vote. Go vote. If we don't like the way the system is funded, if we don't feel that we have enough resources, we must change some of the dynamics in Raleigh so there is a fair funding formula in our schools in the state of North Carolina. The other point I want to make is, and this is what I call a Sharonism. You can have anything you want, you just can't have everything you want. So we have to decide, is it class size reduction? Do we want to save all of the positions in the district? Is it more arts program? This community has to prioritize, and then we can take action. But we can't, there is an end to the amount of money that we receive. It's not endless. So we have to prioritize how we are going to spend scarce resources. But everybody has thrown, just think, just in this room in 15 minutes, how many things have been thrown out that we would like. All of these items have merit, and children deserve them all. But right now, we don't have those resources. I would encourage you, however, I happen to know this number off the top of my head. Dudley High School receives $569,000 a year in Title I funds. That's supplemental funds. The teachers and principal together are supposed to determine how those supplemental funds are used to support the education of poor children. That's what that money is for. So while the district doesn't have additional funds right now to give you more materials, there are some resources in your building. I recommend that school leadership teams get together and prioritize how to spend that money, which is on top of your basic allocation that you receive from the district.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And to all of our educators who are here present tonight, we take this opportunity to thank you for what you do every day. Thank you, and we appreciate you. Ms. James, and then if there are any others who want to answer the question, in your opinion, what and where can we improve?
One area that we haven't talked about is our suspension rate and our disciplinary area of Guilford County Schools. I don't have the statistics for the whole county, but I do know that it appears that it is disproportionate among our people of color in the Guilford County school system. I'm very concerned because you can't learn if you're not in school. That's just a basic. I mean, it's not rocket science. If you're not in the classroom, if you're not being taught in the classroom, you cannot learn. So that's going to affect graduation. It's going to affect, you know, your school, your test scores. It's going to affect everything. So I think we need to. I think for some reason, I have an answer, but I have a suggestion. I don't have an answer. I have a suggestion that we look at the kinds of things students are suspended for. The length of time students are suspended, alternatives to suspension, because some kids come to school and they want to be suspended, so they have a reason to be out of school. I mean, that's just reality. I have two sons. They weren't ever suspended, but I know some of their friends were, and they were happy. I mean, it was a fun time for them. When they go to in-school suspension, that's like playground. That's like, you know, I'm having fun. And that's something's wrong with that picture. We need to look at and rethink the whole suspension, the whole discipline, whatever area in our school.
I can tell you without looking at the numbers here in Guilford County, they are probably just like everywhere else, where you have disproportionate numbers of black and Latinos being suspended, disproportionate numbers of males, black males and Latino males being suspended. So it is a national dilemma. I gave a briefing before the US Congress about this issue and trying to turn it around for students. What most people don't know is that students who are suspended are more likely to be arrested, more likely to be incarcerated, more likely to be dropouts, more likely to depend on public assistance. The list goes on and on. And as you said, it's not rocket science. In order to learn, you need to be in school. There are extensive studies that suspension does not make schools any safer. But it's just something we feel like, oh, they misbehave. They need to be out of school. Well, when you're out of school, you don't learn better behavior. You learn the bad things because your parents are likely working while you're watching more than 1,000 channels of some of the worst filth I've ever seen, things that I couldn't imagine knowing about as a child or a teenager, because there were only 3 channels when I was coming up. But I just think about that we need more alternatives, because certainly schools must be safe. So we can't have violent acts in school. We can't have criminal activities in our schools. But we must create alternative situations for students so that they can change their behavior. And that's what discipline is really about. It's not meant to penalize students. It is meant to change. So I often talk to teachers when they say, this student cursed at me. And I said, do you want them to stop cursing at you, or do you just want me to punish them? And I think any of us educators would say, we want them to stop cursing. We want their behavior to change in the classroom. That takes resources to get to the root cause of the behavior. That takes social workers. It takes mental health clinicians. It takes counselors in schools, so that we can keep more students in school, but teachers are able to manage their classes. But certainly we need to look at, why is it that more children of color across this nation are suspended every day for the same incident, the same infraction? We have to take a deep dive into that.
Are there any more responses to that question? There is, Aura. And the question is, and your opinion, where can we improve as a district?
Okay, I wasn't going to stay because I'm not dressed, so we admit, I'm under this, wait a minute. I can't hear, okay. My name is Tanya Thacker. My children are sophomores here. They're in the academy section at Delhi. And to piggyback on what she said, the suspension rate, I don't know about it, but I know that some parents are held accountable when the suspensions go too high. I work in mental health, so I deal with a lot of kids who would get suspended, who would want to get suspended so they can go home and lay down. And I would have to go to court with some of them. And one parent was in court being held accountable because her child had missed so many days of school. So they went in High Point and brought the parent in. So some of that, you know, that may work to help deal with the suspension problem, because I'm not trying to get off my job because my child wants to cut a fool, and he understands that. He's been suspended one time, period, in 10th grade, you know, which is good for him because we have temper. So we're working on it. But also the inequality between Dudley and, say, Grimsley, or Dudley and Page, or Smith and Page, a lot of it has to do with the parent involvement, because the parents can be involved. This is a Title I school, so we don't have all those resources on the parent side. So if there was more information, better information on how the monies are being divided at the school board level, not just from the outside resources, because while I could do some things, I can't do it by myself. Like you said, I would love for these kids to be able to go on field trips. I understand the trip to D.C. is not happening, you know, that the academy wanted to have. They don't have the money to do it, and they don't have the resources. But foreign exchange programs are going on at Grimsley and going on at High Point Central, yeah, that I went to last year and I went to just the other week. I put my name on the list. Nobody contacted me. I want my children to be exposed to things, so I work at that. But if Dudley's not on the list, you know, for the monies that they're offering, to how can that happen? So that would be my suggestion for an improvement. More resources, more exposure to
more
something outside.
About
more transparency.
How money is spent. Thank you.
How the money is spent, where it's coming in and where it's going. Thank you.
So let me just provide some semblance of an answer, not directly to everything that you said, but the board has taken the philosophy as it relates to Title I money, that we want to give some money to more schools rather than giving more money to a smaller number of schools who have larger number of students who are qualify for Title I funding. So there was a huge debate on the board as to how low do we want to drop to schools receiving Title I funding. Keep in mind, there are poor students all over the district in every school. And so the board's philosophy was that we would give Title I funds to more schools since there are students in poverty all over the district. There was some serious debate, and the vote was very close because there were others who wanted to concentrate the money where there were larger concentrations of poor students. So when you talk about Title I money, when you say Title I schools, there are way more Title I schools in Guilford County than you probably would imagine, because the board's philosophy has been to reach more students. Thank you. Anyone else want to respond to the question, how do we improve? Okay. And then we'll move to our third question of the night. Thank you.
I think that a lot of the problems come from a disparity between the amount of money that's allotted for charter schools and special programs like the middle college programs. For example, I taught drama at Dudley High School, and there was no budget. Every play that we presented, I had to use my own money to build a set, to pay for costumes, for everything that we did here at Dudley. When I taught drama at the middle college at Greensboro, there was all kinds of money. When I taught newspaper journalism here, there was no money for us to produce a newspaper. I had 32 students in my class and 4 computers that were donated by the parents. When I taught the same class at Greensboro Middle College, there were 17 students in the class. We had a printer that would allow us to print our own newspaper at school. We had state-of-the-art cameras. I had to buy the cameras when I was at Dudley for my students to use and pay to have the pictures developed. There's a disparity. This should not happen in a school system where all of us pay taxes. There shouldn't be something on one side of town that we don't have here on this side of town. The school should not be that significant. There shouldn't be that big a difference in the supplies that are available for the students in these classes.
I just want to ask, Dr. Martin, I see you here. Are schools given an allocation of funding? Okay, so I just want, while we are going to really look into equity of funding, I also want to point out principals have a great deal of discretion in how to spend their budget. We don't tell them how to spend their budget. So there may be principals who spend a lot on library media services and not spend as much on drama. So I don't want you to think all of this is coming from the board, the superintendent, or central office. They receive a set amount of money each year, an allocation. It certainly isn't enough. But then the school makes choices about how that money is spent. I just want us all to be clear on that, that central office, the board, is not saying, don't give money to drama, give money to technology club. A lot of this happens at the school level.
Thank you very much. Let me also take this time to invite everyone to participate in the budget process, which is always open to the public and always hosts public forums. The beginning of building the budget takes place in January of every year, and it is a long process. It takes over months. So beginning in January of 2017, you have the right, the responsibility, and the say-so of being a part of the board's budgeting process. The board goes through the budget line by line. We take a day where we go through every line on the budget and talk about the allocations of funding. That's just to let you know you are invited to participate in that process and to raise your voice, because oftentimes, as the superintendent has pointed out, and as you have pointed out, there are things that are happening up here when we're putting together a budget that don't match with what is happening on the ground, and that's where your input is critical. Ms. Hargett, good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Amos. Good evening, Ms. Contreras. I want to say that what concerns me, I've been at Dudley 17 years, and what concerns me most is our community. Our input. Our kids here are doing so many positive things. We have so many things that our kids are being successful at. But it starts here at our community. And we are lacking that. And it disappoints me. We are giving our kids a disservice. I am trying to reach out. We have a homecoming parade. I have National Technical Honor Society. I have all the great things that our kids are doing. But I go to Chick-fil-A, and the sign I see up is Grimsley High School. I go in and I ask, what can Dudley do? But that's us connecting. But I'm only one person, and I can't go to Chick-fil-A. I can't call all these companies, and I'm doing that, and I'm trying. But I'm hearing complaints. But I need to see you guys in the school, helping our kids, keeping them here. Stop looking at what we got negative. We have so many positive things going on here at Dudley High School. I went to school here. My family went to school here. It is meaning. I left 1 year, went to Andrews. Mr. Wiles brought me back here. I have been sick, had cancer, all of that. But it has not stopped my heart from what I feel for here. But we're not giving back. We got automotives doing great things, but we need the money. Our community, give back, help us to go on these field trips, to do the job shadowing. You know, I'm asking the kids, can you give $5? If you want to be a National Technical Honor Society, it's $35. If you don't have it, I will ask to see what I can get somebody to give. But if we as one unit help each other, our kids here, our 1,500, do the job shadowing. Go to Chick-fil-A so that we can have a night, even though it's not on our side of town, but we can get some of that funding. All of these things, if we do them, our kids can go to DC. The exchange program at Grimsley, it was open to anybody that wanted to come. Just go over there to Grimsley. So, come, just like you're here now. We have events. We have PTSA. We may have 10 people in our meetings. You go to Grimsley, it's the whole community. But you're sitting here fussing about what we're not doing. We got to take care of our own. And I have to leave on that account because I'm getting emotional. Thank you.
All right. Thank you all very much for your responses to that second of our three questions. And now the final question. What advice would you give to Superintendent Contreras and the board that will assist us in soaring to greatness? And that is our goal, that we will soar to greatness. What advice would you give to Superintendent Contreras and the Board of Education that will assist us in soaring to greatness?
I would definitely advocate for the superintendent and the board to pass a resolution recognizing career status for our teachers. I thought the lawsuit handled that, but it just handled those teachers who already had tenure. For those teachers who are teaching less than 4 or 5 years in our school district, their contract is renewable. They don't have due process. If they're canceled, they're gone. They don't have a right to appeal to the board. That is something we can do as a board before the end of this year, is to pass that. We can't pay them a living wage. We can make sure if they feel that they are unjustly terminated or referred to another school, they have the right to appeal and a right to due process. I also feel it's important to again, to continue to advocate for education, again, with the transparency that's going on here. I would love if we could do a community review board for our community. Our community is not aware that 90% of our budget, of the $700 million approximately, is salary. They're not aware that we're on rotation. They're definitely not aware that four of our county commissioners were at the opening of Gateway Charter School this morning. And two of those county commissioners sit on the board of charter schools. So we don't have a majority when it comes to our county commissioners. And we get approximately $6 million to maintenance and repair 127 schools. But our community isn't aware of those logistics and the fact that the board and the county commissioner don't communicate. We need to push and strive for communication, a dual town hall meeting with the county commissioners and with the school board, because the county commissioners supplement the funding that the state doesn't give us. And now they're wanting charter, and they have a majority for charter.
Thank you very much. As we move to the next speaker, Mr. Gladden pointed out something that's very important for all of us to understand. There are 127 schools in Guilford County, 127 educational environments. Some of them are on college campuses, as you know. And the budget for maintenance of those is $6 million, which is an increase that it has been for over the past couple of years. When I first came on the board in 2004, when we didn't have 127 schools, we had $12 million to maintain the schools. We went from $12 million to $3 million to $5 million to $6 million. Let me give you this analogy. It is like owning a home and only having $10 per year for home maintenance. That's not overly dramatic. Just imagine if you're a homeowner or rent or whatever, and you have $10. If the roof goes out, if the water heater goes out, if carpet or damage in a flood or anything like that, you have $10 to pay for it. That is an example of how little money we have to maintain 127 schools. All right, someone else who has advice for our superintendent and for the board?
Good evening. My name is Dot Timmons, and I am a Bison from High Point Central, High Point, North Carolina. I volunteer here at Dudley High School. I met three guys 3 years ago, class of 76, and they asked me to become a part of the Dudley Hometown Foundation. I volunteer almost every day. I come and I ask what's needed done, and I do it. I work with Ms. Scott and the administration. I work with the students. I start at the prom for the students who'd never been to the prom. The second year I did the prom, they asked me to go to the prom with them. I said, I can't go to the prom, I can't do that. They said, why not? Miss Dot, have you ever been to the prom? I said, no. I couldn't go because both parents were ill. I was a cheerleader and student council student council president, but I couldn't go to the prom. So I was embarrassed. I was very embarrassed. I went to the prom for the first time in my life just last year, and we had a ball. I look at the students here every day, and they have so much joy in their eyes. And I asked Mr. Wiles if I could come in and take the closet in the back room, which is right adjacent to the detention room. I go in that room every day, I fold clothes, I bring in clothes, and I'm not saying this is what I do just because I do it. I'm saying that I am here, and I'm from High Point Central. No one asked me to come here. They didn't pull my hair, I don't have much hair anyway, to get here. But I'm saying I don't see the involvement of the community. And you may be upset with me when I leave here, but parents, I don't see you. We are always asking the administration to do what we need them to do, but we're not doing it as parents. I'm a parent for every student. And the teachers, they work hard. I work with Ms. Myers. I asked her last year to make some posters for the class of 76 so that we could have a fundraiser. And she had her students make the most awesome signs, a fish fry. So we don't see what's in the classrooms because we're not here. You have to come here. You have to help these teachers. You have to help the principal. You have to pat them on the back. And you have to say, I'm here. It's not just the school board. It's not just the county. It's not the state. It's not Washington, D.C. It's us. And you have to let your kids know that you want to be here for them so that they can help the administration too. These two people here are very powerful, and they're sitting here waiting for us to get up, because they've already gotten up. They're already there. We are not there as parents, and we have to be. So I'm saying to you, I'm not here to brag on what I do. It's from my heart. I don't like seeing these kids getting kicked out. I asked Mr. Wiles if I could have that closet, because I heard a conversation one day about the homeboys going home. They're going to go party. Do you not realize that some of your kids come to school dressed as they come because they know that they may have to go home, or they know that they have to go to detention? Do you know sometimes they're smarter than we are? So it's up to us to check our children before they leave your home. I don't care how old. You can be 18. You can be 21, check your children. It's not always their responsibility. They are educators. We're parents. So please help me. Please help the administration. Please help this beautiful young lady that they've sent to us who came here because she wanted to be here. She doesn't have to be here. She could be in another country making a whole lot of money. She can. And also, so many other people could. So I'm just saying, I'm not here to make a speech. I'm not trying to run for president against Hillary. I'm saying, help Dudley High School stay Dudley High School. It's the Dudley High School I knew at 6 and 7 years old. And when I got 14, they closed William Penn and High Point. I had so much desire to go to William Penn, but they closed it down. So I came here to homecoming as a kid from High Point, North Carolina. Packed to lunch, packed breakfast for lunch, because that's all we had, and we came here. So I'm supposed to be here today. Feel good about your community. Feel good about your school. Go next door and ask them to volunteer. Go down the street. Tell your churches what you need. It's just not always about them. They can't do it all. Mr. Moore and the administration, Mr. Wiles, it's not about them all the time. Look in the mirror when you go home, because I'm going to look again. Thank you.
I appreciate it. All right. We just have time for one more, and that's her, and then we will end. Thank you very much. Yeah.
I was trying to just peek in. I didn't plan to stand. But I'm Tasha Cruz, and I'd like to say respond to what this young lady was saying. I have a child over here, but I heavily volunteer at my son's school because I saw the need to actually really be there a little more because I have a very active son. So that's where I spend most of my volunteering time. Also, I just wanted to say to the parents that do want to get involved, I have to be very honest. I really don't hear any opportunities. I mean, yes, I should probably come and ask, but I honestly don't get Connect Eds and things like that from Dudley High, because I'm always listening for Connect Ed, because we get them all the time at Harrison, because I also help with the Ed Connect. So I really don't hear, I don't know who your communication person is, but I really don't get any information from Dudley, to be very honest with you. Secondly, I just wanted to say that what advice would I give? Number one, always pray. The second one, communicate all progressions or all progress as soon as possible. So hopefully that'll build more hope and momentum. So, you know, as we get good news, let's report it really quickly so that, you know, we can say, hey, we're doing something good, and we can build that momentum, and people can want, you know, people will want to get more involved. Also, maybe communicate through other channels of communication. I know we have the GCS TV, but maybe a little more radio feed and things like that, just to get more information out there about different things that are going on within the school system. And I just want to thank everyone for being here, because this is awesome that we're actually here tonight. And I just want to thank you all for being here and listening.
Thank you very much. And thank all of you again for being here tonight. Again, I appreciate your input. This is not just a one-time thing. Dr. Contreras, who will close us out with her closing remarks, is very open to hearing from you as often as possible, and also to hearing your ideas as she completes her tenure, which we hope will be a very long tenure here at Guilford County Schools. On a personal note, I want to thank you for 12 years of support. As many of you know, I have 3 school board meetings left, and then I will not be on the Board of Education anymore as I prepare to go to the North Carolina State House representing this very district, District 58, beginning in January. As the day draws closer, I get more and more nostalgic, and I probably will wind up crying at some point in time, because it has been an absolute pleasure to serve as your voice and your representative on Guilford County Schools. I can say to Dr. Contreras that what I have been is a voice, but the power of this community lies in this people. And one thing about Dudley High School is that there is no lack of power, because there's no lack of people who have pride in this school. And so you will be well, and Dudley will take care of you, because Dudley believes in taking care of its school. So again, thank you very much for 12 years of support. As Ms. Cruz just said, I appreciate your prayers as I move to another location as far as working on your behalf. I've heard what you said also. I will get to work as soon as I hit the ground in Raleigh. I love you very much. I appreciate you. And may there always be a Dudley High.
So first, I'd like to thank you all for coming out tonight. I want to thank Reverend Quick. He said at some point he will cry. I cry every night thinking he left me, he hired me, and he's going to leave me. But he assured me that he will continue supporting the school district and fighting the good fight in our state capital. So we are grateful to have you there. I want to thank Principal Wiles for your support. I know you're back there somewhere. Thank you so much for your leadership here. We appreciate you. Certainly to the teachers, we're going to continue fighting for you. We know you need supplies and materials. We will continue to fight. And to all of you as parents, I thank you for your commitment to not just Dudley, but to all of the schools. I don't want schools to compete against one another. We have to find ways to make sure 100% of the children in this county receive a great education, not just competing for scarce resources, but how do we fight to make sure every child has what they need? I so look forward to working with all of you. I'm grateful to serve, and I see this as a position of service. You know, people come up to me and sometimes they act as though they're in awe, and I said, look, I'm just Sharon from around the way. You know, I am just someone that is here to serve you as the parents, to serve the children, to serve this community, because I believe in the power of a public education to change lives. It makes you walk a little straighter. It makes you smile a little bigger. It makes you feel I'm confident and I can do anything. I know that because of what education did for me. And I want to make sure that no child in this county, in this country, feels that they cannot get a great education in our public schools. But most of all, what I want you to know is I love your children. I mean that from so deep within. I love them, I believe in them, and because I believe in them, I am never going to give up on them. Thank you so much for coming out tonight.
We want to thank all of our educators who are here. We know that many of you have to be in buildings tomorrow, so we thank you for your time here tonight. I want to thank those who have recorded this meeting for us tonight and who have made sure that this meeting will be preserved and shown again. Also, the superintendent, this is the first of many, so please check our website, gcsnc.com, to find out where the superintendent will be next, and please go and participate in those. May heaven smile upon you. Please have a good night.